Hi everybody, welcome to my YouTube channel Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts and my FB page Dr. Srinivas Concepts. This is Dr. Srinivas, neurologist from Andhra Pradesh, India. I'm also the medical author of the book Focused Neurology. Today we are going to discuss a very interesting and important topic, the mechanisms of sleep and narcolepsy. To understand narcolepsy and various sleep disorders, we should first understand the mechanism of sleep. So the mechanisms of sleep. Basically, we can divide the mechanisms into two types. One, the mechanisms which promote wakefulness, and the other system which inhibits the wakefulness and promotes sleep. So the system which is responsible for wakefulness is known as the ascending arousal system. This is known as an ascending arousal system. It is predominantly present in the brainstem, more so in the pons and the midbrain. So this is the ascending arousal system which keeps all of us in a wakeful state. There are few chemical substances which promote wakefulness, like cholinergic, that is acetylcholine, glutamatergic and monoaminergic. So these systems will keep us in a awake state, but by promoting the arousal system, ascending arousal system. We need to understand a very important neuropeptide, orexin, or otherwise known as hypocretin, which is produced by hypothalamus. This orexin or hyporectin reinforces and stabilizes the ascending arousal system so as to keep all of us in an awake state. Narcolepsy is because of the lack or deficiency of orexin, which promotes wakefulness. And therefore, when in narcolepsy, orexin is deficient, wakefulness is not being able to be promoted, and therefore person slips into a sleepy state. That is narcolepsy. So narcolepsy is because of loss of orexin. As I said, the acetylcholine, cholinergic, noradrenergic, glutamatergic systems reinforce, along with orexin, the ascending arousal system. So substances which inhibit these will promote sleep, like H1 antagonist. Histamine is important to promote wakefulness by stimulating the arousal system, and therefore when we give antihistamines, they act on histamine and decrease or diminish the activity of the ascending arousal system and promote sleepiness. Likewise, muscarinic antagonist, amitriptyline, which acts on acetylcholine and therefore promotes sleep, and alpha-2 agonist. So this is about the wakefulness, the ascending arousal system. In parallel, we have another system, the GABAergic arousal inhibiting system. So the GABAergic system inhibits the arousal system and therefore promotes sleepiness. So the potential chemicals or potentiators of this GABAergic inhibitory system of the arousal system, which promotes sleepy state or sleepiness, are benzodiazepines, barbiturates, ethanol, alcohol. That's why when they take a lot of alcohol, they become sleepy soon. And then chloral hydrate. So this is about the importance of the sleep and wakefulness state. Basically, wakefulness, we need to know about two important concepts. One, the ascending arousal system, which keeps all of us in an awake state. It goes in the brainstem and diffuses to both the cortices. So as long as the RA system is intact, we are awake. But the moment the RA system is affected, either in the brainstem or both the cortices, person loses consciousness and physiologically he becomes sleepy. If one cortex gets affected, person does not lose consciousness. So both the cortices should get affected or the brainstem should get affected, because the ascending arousal system goes from the brainstem centrifugally into both the cortices. This system can be anatomically disrupted or metabolically disrupted, like benzodiazepines, barbiturates, ethanol. Right. There are three important questions about which I just said, but important points so that we remember it. One, when we fall asleep, for example, when we are driving the car and we are falling asleep, immediately we shake our head like this or look like this and induce hyperkinesia. We induce a movement, either movement of the head or movement of the body. It's a physiological response. Nature has given a very good physiological response. So when you fall, when you're about to fall asleep, when you have hyperkinesia, when you have kinesia induces or enhances the secretion of this hormone orexin or hypocretin from hypothalamus. Orexin is a wakefulness promoting substance, and therefore when you are about to fall asleep, when you shake your head or your body, orexin is produced and the sleep is inhibited and you become awake. That's a very good natural protection, because if we are driving the car and we fall asleep, we may indulge in road traffic accidents. So when you are about to fall asleep, when you shake yourself, the sleep is inhibited and a person becomes awake. Second, we give H1 receptor blockers, anti-allergic substances for allergy, a lot of cutaneous manifestations for any allergic disease. And we always say important side effect of antihistamine is sleep. What is the mechanism? I just touched upon it. Histamine promotes enhances the ascending arousal system, and therefore when histamine is blocked, like H1 receptor antagonist, like cetirizine or chlorpheniramine maleate, it produces sleep as a side effect. And third point, neurologists give anticholinergic drugs, tricyclic antidepressants like amitriptyline, for migraine or for any neurologic conditions. And one of the common side effects again is sleep. What is the mechanism? Again, acetylcholine promotes wakefulness or wakeful state by enhancing and stabilizing the ascending arousal system. And therefore, the moment we block acetylcholine, like giving amitriptyline, tricyclic antidepressant, acetylcholine levels come down and persons have sleep as a side effect. So, allergy like H1 receptor blockers, tricyclic antidepressants, they produce or promote sleep because they block histamine and acetylcholine, which are wakefulness promoting substances. Likewise, when we are about to fall asleep, we shake our head or the body, induce kinesia. Kinesia produces or promotes the secretion of orexin, which is a wakefulness promoting substance, the neuropeptide, and therefore we are awake. Now, these three are very important, pertinent points when we are trying to deal with the sleep physiology. Right, having understood all these basic concepts of sleep, now let's move on to the narcolepsy. But before that, we need to understand another important concept, the two important phases of sleep. One is the non-rapid eye movement sleep, second is the rapid eye movement sleep. The non-rapid eye movement sleep or the rapid eye movement sleep. As we slowly become drowsy and enter stage 1, 2, 3, 4 stages of sleep, we become drowsy, more sleepy and intense sleep, and then finally we sleep as we go down the stages, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4. So we can see nice EEG changes correspondingly. From alpha it becomes theta, from theta it becomes delta. And in between, in the middle phase of the sleep, we see the sleep spindles and K complexes. The non-rapid eye movement is a state where it gives a pleasant sleep. There aren't any movements. These are intermittently replaced by rapid eye movement sleep. In fact, the first rapid eye movement sleep occurs about 1 hour after falling asleep. As the name implies, rapid eye movement sleep, we keep fluttering our eyelids and the eyeballs keeps moving. That's why it's named rapid eye movement phase. Why is this important? During the rapid eye movement sleep, we start dreaming. We get dreams during the REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep. And nature has given a wonderful protection during the REM sleep, wherein our limbs go in for paralysis. We are not able to move our limbs. There is atonia of the limbs during REM sleep. It's a wonderful protection. Why? Because when we go through the stage of the REM sleep and we start dreaming, we may enact our dreams. We may enact our dreams and injure others. And therefore, when we get dreams, our body becomes paralyzed and we cannot enact our dreams. We are totally paralyzed and we are on the bed. So in the REM sleep, three important points take place. Three important points. One, there is a rapid eye movement of the eyeball and the movement of the eyelids, wherein you can see nicely in a person. Second, dreams occur in this state, REM sleep, and if a person is woken up during the REM phase, person vividly remembers the dreams, usually the visual dreams. They can have visual hallucinations also. Third, during this REM phase where we get dreams, our muscles are totally paralyzed and atonia, so that we do not enact our dreams. Why is this important, REM sleep? Because in narcolepsy, two important concepts take place. One, there's a deficiency of orexin or hypocretin, and therefore the wakefulness is inhibited. Person easily slips into sleepiness. Second, in narcolepsy, they directly enter into REM phase. They do not go into NREM stage 1 to 4 and then REM. The REM enters very fast as soon as they sleep, and therefore persons will have a fast REM, and because of the REM intrusions, they'll have all the events which take place in the REM phase. That is, they have vivid dreams, hallucination, and loss of tone. So to the extent of falling down, what we call as cataplexy. So all the concepts of the narcolepsy can be explained by one, lack of hypocretin and therefore or orexin, and therefore a easy way or falling into a sleepy phase very quickly. Second, because of the intrusion of the REM very early into the sleep, you have all the manifestations of the REM, which classically form the tetrad, clinical tetrad of narcolepsy. Now let's see what is this clinical tetrad of narcolepsy. One, there is an excessive daytime sleepiness. Persons keep on sleeping. They may be eating and then they may fall asleep, or they may be talking, they may be indulged in a conversation and they slowly slump into sleepiness. Excessive daytime sleepiness because of the decrease of hypocretin or orexin neuropeptide from the hypothalamus, and therefore they have excessive daytime sleepiness. And as I said earlier, if you keep moving kinesia, this hormone is secreted or produced more, and therefore there could be a decrease in the sleepy state. So the first point in the tetrad is that there is an excessive daytime sleepiness. The second and very specific of narcolepsy is cataplexy. In fact, this state is almost not seen in any other disorder. So highly specific of narcolepsy is cataplexy. As I said, they enter into REM phase very fast. REM state, they have dreams and there's a loss of tone. So a person may be standing, there may be a good joke and he may start laughing. Emotionally, he may get indulged, and excessive laughter or any kind of emotional overtones, that there's a loss of tone and he immediately falls onto the ground. Cataplexy. Loss of tone because of an emotional excitement and falling onto the ground, known as cataplexy. Very, very specific of narcolepsy. In fact, this is not seen in almost any other disorder. Cataplexy. The third is sleep paralysis. So as they sleep and when they enter into the REM phase, the REM phase comes very fast and they develop loss of tone in all four limbs, and even if they want to get up, they can't get up because they are in the REM phase and there's a paralysis of all the limbs. Fourth is the hypnagogic or hypnopompic hallucinations. As they are falling into the sleep phase, or as soon as they get up from sleep, they have hallucination, especially visual hallucinations, especially threatening hallucinations. In fact, they vividly remember, they cannot differentiate whether it is a dream or a hallucination or a reality. It is so clear, it is so vivid that it seems to them that it is actually happening. So these are the four classic findings of narcolepsy. One, excessive daytime sleepiness. Second, cataplexy, very, very specific. They lose the tone, and with some emotional trigger like laughter, they immediately slump and fall onto the floor. They have the sleep paralysis, they'll have hypnopompic or hypnagogic hallucinations. Right. The pathophysiology. As I said, the pathophysiology, narcolepsy is caused by loss of hypothalamic secretion of neuropeptide hormone, the substance orexin or hypocretin, which promotes wakefulness. Because there's a loss of orexin, they have excessive sleepiness. Orexin promotes wakeful state by stimulating the ascending arousal system, and it suppresses REM sleep. And because of the deficiency of orexin, they enter into the REM phase very quickly, and because it cannot now stimulate and stabilize the arousal system, they become sleepy. So two important concepts: because of lack of orexin, they sleep fast and they enter into the REM phase fast. Narcolepsy typically begins between the ages of 10 to 25 years. That is the age when we usually diagnose narcolepsy. And the pathophysiology, it is presumed to be autoimmune in nature, because we have seen some persons with narcolepsy getting the narcolepsy because post-vaccination or post-viral infection. So it is presumed and it is speculated to be autoimmune in nature. Diagnosis. How do we diagnose this? Clinically, as I said, of all these four components, a very specific component of all these four components, the tetrad, is cataplexy. It is very specific of narcolepsy. In fact, it is not found in any other disorder. So it occurs in all, it does not occur in almost any disease. It is very specific to narcolepsy. There's a loss of tone. So someone cracks a joke, they start laughing, only to fall down onto the floor because of loss of tone. Cataplexy, triggered by an emotional event, usually laughter, and they fall onto the ground because of the loss of tone. Second, objective way of demonstrating narcolepsy is by polysomnography and multiple sleep latency test. Multiple sleep latency test. When we do the multiple sleep latency test, it involves several short naps. Person will have several short naps and then we start recording. So what happens is that we monitor the latency of the sleep onset. So as soon as we start recording, when they start getting asleep, when they are about to fall asleep, we measure the latency, and we measure the latency of the REM onset. So we measure the latency of sleep onset, we measure the latency of the REM onset. So we usually take about 5 naps. Across the 5 naps, at least 2 of the naps should have the REM sleep intrusion. And usually when we take 5 naps, the narcolepsy will fall asleep in less than 8 minutes. So the time period, the time duration is taken as 8 minutes, and they usually fall asleep within 8 minutes. And another way of confirming the narcolepsy is by CSF analysis. As I said, narcolepsy is because of lack of hypocretin or orexin. So when the level of orexin in the CSF is less than 110 picograms per ml, it is diagnostic of narcolepsy. So the treatment of narcolepsy basically consists of two components. One, the treatment of the sleepy state. So we have to give wakefulness promoting medication. Second, treatment of cataplexy, that is loss of tone. So we have to give antidepressants which suppress the REM intrusion. So the treatment basically consists of two components. One, treatment of narcolepsy, that is excessive daytime sleepiness. We treat it by giving wakefulness promoting substances. Second, treatment of cataplexy, we treat by giving antidepressants which suppress the REM intrusion. So the first is the treatment of narcolepsy, wakefulness promoting substances like modafinil, 200 to 400 milligrams OD we give. It is commonly used because it has got less side effects, but we can use other drugs, but then they have side effects like methylphenidate, 10 milligrams BD, and dextroamphetamine, again 10 milligrams BD. Sodium oxybutate is also used. For treatment of cataplexy, we use antidepressants like tricyclic antidepressants like nortriptyline, or we give SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors like fluoxetine. Fluoxetine we give about 10 to 40 milligrams, and nortriptyline we give about again 10 to 40 milligrams. Again, we can give sodium oxybutrate for cataplexy also. So primarily the treatment of narcolepsy includes treatment of excessive sleepiness by giving wakefulness promoting substances like modafinil and amphetamines. Second, treatment of cataplexy by giving antidepressants like SSRIs and tricyclic antidepressants. So this is the overview of the mechanisms of sleep and narcolepsy. We need to understand basically the wakefulness is because of the ascending arousal system, wherein substances like histamine, acetylcholine, glutamine, noradrenaline, noradrenergic substances help and stabilize it. But very important is orexin or hyporectin, which stabilizes and reinforces this ascending arousal system. Drugs enhance GABA, GABAergic system, which inhibits this arousal system, like GABAergic drugs like benzodiazepines, barbiturates, ethanol and chloral hydrate, and therefore they are sleep promoting agents which we use commonly to in person suffering from insomnia, like zolpidem, which is nothing but benzodiazepine. The three interesting questions is that when we are about to fall asleep, we immediately shake our head and our body. It is because when we shake our head and body, the kinesia releases orexin, which will promote wakefulness, and anticholinergics and antihistamines, they produce sleep as side effect, because histamine and acetylcholine are wakefulness promoting substances because they act on the ascending arousal system, and therefore when they are inhibited, sleep is produced as a side effect. I hope you have enjoyed listening to my lecture. If you have any suggestions or comments, kindly post onto my YouTube channel. But please like and subscribe my YouTube channel, Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts, and my FB page, Dr. Srinivas Concepts. Thank you. Bye.